There's this pattern in React that's actually in the React docs and that I've seen mentioned a few times online, but honestly, it's just so weird and so unusual. I want to talk about it because although you will rarely use it, it's important to know and understand how it works, and it will actually teach you a lot about the React render cycle and the process. And also, if you haven't heard, I just launched Project React, which is a course where you learn React by building a real world project. If you're interested, it'll be the first link in the description. So here I have a simple app component. This component receives item as props. Items is an array of strings. And then we have selected items, which is a piece of state that is used to track which items are currently selected. Our goal, as you can see over here, is to reset selected items whenever the items prop changes, right? So we have items over here. Whenever this changes, we want to reset selected items, which makes sense. If we have a different set of items, we want to reset which ones are selected and basically start fresh and all over again. Now keep in mind that in this example, items will only change in the parent. We cannot actually influence or affect how items changes. The only thing that we can do is write code to actually react to that change. So how do we do that? Well, one naive approach might be to create a use effect that listens to items, and then whenever that changes, we'll reset the selected items to an empty array, right? That seems to make sense. So let's do it. Let's come here and let's define use effect. So we're going to do use effect like this, import this from React. This is going to be a function, and then we're going to do set selected items and then an empty array, and we're going to pass here items like so, right? So we have a use effect. We're passing items in the dependency array. So this use effect is going to run once on mount, and then whenever items changes, and whenever items actually changes, we're going to set the selected items to an empty array, thus resetting our state, right? Fair enough. Now this is technically going to work. It's functionally correct, if you will. It will achieve our goal of actually resetting selected items whenever items changes, right? So it is going to do that, but it's not the most efficient way of achieving that goal, right? Because first of all, it's going to do it in two render passes, right? Because this use effect is asynchronous, it's not going to actually block the rendering to actually execute this code. So it's going to do this work in two render passes. But also on the first render, we're actually going to have and risk having stale data where we have selected items that doesn't necessarily match the items that we receive from props. Right? I mean, let's say that on the first render, you have items over here and you have an array of 10 items, let's just say, right? So items is going to be an array of 10 items. On that first render, you're going to have items here. Then you're going to have selected items, which is going to be an empty array. And then you have all of your code that is going to update selected items. Let's say that you have some checkboxes for each individual item and you press the checkbox to select these items. Then let's say that items changes in the parent, because again, we're not changing it in this component. We're changing it in the parent component. What's going to happen is items changing is going to cause a re-render of this component. This is going to then run all of the code and actually render the UI based on the new items on that render. But this code over here is not going to run on that render because, as we know, as we said, use effect is asynchronous. That is going to run on the next render. So you're going to have a situation where you have items that changes, maybe not from 10 items, it went down to 5 items, and those get reflected in the UI. But now this use effect is going to run, and then it's going to actually set the selected items to an empty array, but it's only going to be visible in the second render and the render after that. So not only are you doing this in two render passes, but if you ever had selected items that actually depended on one of the 5 items that are no longer there, right? We had 10 initially, now we have 5. If selected items was one of those 5 items that got removed in that first render, before use effect actually gets run, you have selected items that is referencing items that are no longer there, and your application might actually throw an error because you're trying to access items that are not there. Right? So you have to be really careful whenever you're doing things like this, whenever you're using use effect like this, because you're going to run into these problems. And if you're not careful, you might end up shipping this into production, and then your application is going to crash in production in front of your users, and you're going to have no idea that this is actually what caused it, right? So this is not the right approach. So let's come here and let's remove all of this because we need to find a different way to do it. Well, what is the right approach? Well, let me tell you, the right approach is actually something that you're not going to expect. So first, what we're going to do is we're going to come here and we're going to create a new state variable to hold the previous set of items. So that is going to be the items of the previous render. So we're going to come here and do const prev items set prev items, and that is going to be equal to use state, and we're also going to give this here string and then an empty array like so. And here we're going to instantiate this to actual items. So on that first initial render, whatever items that we have here, we're going to pass it as the initial value of the previous items. So prev items over here, its only responsibility is going to keep track of the items of the previous render, because items here does not tell you anything about what value this was in the previous render. For that, you have to track it yourself and you have to create a new state variable to be able to do it. Then what we want to do is we want to make a check that if prev items is different than items, then we want to reset selected items to an empty array, right? So that's the only thing that we want to do. And to do that, what we're going to do is we're going to come here and do it directly inside of the component as it is rendering. So we're going to come here, we're going to do if prev items is not equal to items, then inside of the render, we're going to do set selected items to an empty array. And then we're going to do set prev items to items, like so. So now with this, we've actually solved our problem and we've achieved our goal. We are resetting selected items every time that items changes, but we're doing it in a very weird and unconventional way. So how does this work, right? Because this is weird. We're not used to seeing this in React. We're not used to actually setting state and updating state as the component is rendering. And the question that you might have is, can we even do this in React? Well, the truth is, yes, you can. And in this case, you actually should. So let's walk through this code, right? Let's take it one step at a time, one render cycle at a time. So first, on the initial render, we have items, which is an array of 10 items. We're going to use the same value as we had before. So in that first render, items is an array of 10 items. Selected items is going to be an empty array. And then prev items is going to get initiated with the value of items, which is going to be also an array of 10 items. So then prev items here is going to be the same as items. So this code is not going to run on that first render. Then we have our UI. The user is actually going to take some check boxes and update selected items. And then at some point, items is going to change. We're going to go from 10 items to 5 items. Then we're going to have a new render. So items now is going to only have 5 items. Prev items is still going to have 10 items, the previous value of items. And so this code over here now, because prev items is different than items, is going to return true. And this code is going to run. So when this code runs, it's going to set selected items to an empty array, and then it's going to set prev items to the new items from this current render. So now what happens when we're setting state while the component is currently rendering? Because here we're not inside of a function, we're not inside of a use effect, we're directly setting state while the component is rendering. When that happens, what React is going to do is it's going to do a partial render. What that means is that React is going to run these functions and then is going to continue and run any other code, for example, useEffect or any other hooks or any other variables, until it gets to the return function, like so. It is going to stop at the return function and is not going to actually render anything, but it's going to abandon that render partially. And I say partially because it still did this work over here all the way up to the return function. And then it's going to update these variables here. It's going to set them in the state and it's going to trigger a new re-render of the component, and that time is going to go all the way and then actually run this return function. Because when that happens, we're going to set selected items to an empty array, we're going to set prev items to items, and then in that next render that we've abandoned partially, now prev items is going to have the same value as items, so this code is not going to run on that third render, so we're going to be able to complete this and actually get to the return function. That's how this works. Now, it's important to note that this only works because we are inside of an if statement. If we weren't, this would basically result in an infinite loop, right? You have this component that would try to render some things, then these functions would get called, it would then send the rendering back over here, it would try to render again, and this would run indefinitely. So for this to work, you have to be inside of an if statement. And the second thing that is important to note is that this also only works if the thing that you're updating inside of the if statement are things that belong to this component. So we're setting prev items over here, which is a state that belongs to this component. If we were trying to actually set some state of a parent component through perhaps an updater function, this would error because you cannot do that in React, and React is going to throw an error. So this only works if this is inside of an if statement and if the actual values that we're trying to update are owned inside of the current component that is rendering. So what do you do with this? Well, honestly, in most cases, nothing. You probably won't be using this too often in your React applications, but sometimes, some very, very rare times, you just might, and this might actually come in handy. And this is a better solution in those cases than using useEffect, as I've just shown here. So if that happens, if you're trying to use useEffect for something and you have this little thought in the back of your head that's saying that maybe there's a different way to do it, listen to that intuition and try to think about this and come back to this video and see if this situation applies, because you never know, it just might. And now you know how to do it. And more importantly, you know that it's okay to do something like this, even if it feels very, very unusual. And if you want to learn more about React and learn more about these cool little things like that, check out Project React, which is a course that teaches you React by building a real-world project where we literally see A to Z what it takes to build a big and complex application with React. If you're interested, it'll be the first link in the description. If you enjoyed this video and you want to see more videos just like this one, make sure to leave this video a big thumbs up. You can also click here to subscribe, or you can click here to watch a different video of mine that YouTube seems to think that you're really going to enjoy. And with that being said, my name has been Darius Kozden. This is Kozden Solutions. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Ciao, ciao.